Welcome, everyone, to the launch of the Dashboard for Rapid Vehicle Electrification, version 2.0. My name is Steph Wagner, the Technical Program Associate for the Electrification Coalition. For those of you who aren't familiar with our work, the EC is a nonpartisan nonprofit organization that advances policies and actions to facilitate the widespread deployment and adoption of electric vehicles to reduce the economic, public health, and national security risk caused by America's dependence on oil. And I will say, I am pleased to see so many folks joining us for a packed agenda. First, we will set the context for the drive tool and give a brief walkthrough on the newest update, followed by a Q&A session. If you have any questions during the presentation, this webinar, please send them to the Q&A section on Zoom. And without further ado, let's jump right in. Okay, for background on the drive tool's creation, the EC and its developer, Atlas Public Policy, noticed public fleet managers without the tools to make their case for fleet electrification. Since its first release in 2021, our combined team has focused on creating and improving an accessible, easy-to-use tool that analyzes fleet data in minutes. And best of all, it's free to use and download. Using your feedback, we have brought light, medium, and heavy-duty fleet analysis under one tool, which typically is done in separate analyses. And as an easy-to-use application, the drive tool provides the following uses. It limits the amount of time and cost for a standard fleet analysis, which can take a lot of time, months even, is very expensive, and can be difficult to interpret. It can also provide a total cost of ownership or TCO analysis and other data in minutes, and it can integrate multiple factors important for tailoring the data to your fleet, including fuel costs, purchase prices, insurance, federal and state incentives, infrastructure costs, and so much more. Ultimately, the drive tool can make your case for electrification while allowing you to see any needed fleet improvements, such as right sizing. And now, moving on to actual operations of the tool, data pull comes primarily from the Federal Highway Administration, the Department of Energy, the Environmental Protection Agency, and fueleconomy.gov, all of which are open source and publicly available. We regularly update the Drive Tools database so that default inputs are accurate and improvements are being made. And as an important note, it also runs on Windows operating system or OS and is for on-road vehicles only. So to get started on a basic fleet analysis, the drive tool just needs three data inputs. First, the vehicle identification number, a 17-digit unique code for each car, the other two listed, which are the annual vehicle miles traveled or mileage, and the vehicle life expectancy, which is essentially the year the vehicle was made and put on the road to the year that you plan on retiring it. Both of which, if you don't have handy, you can provide rough estimates on for the full fleet. Additionally, if you want to stay up to date on our newest versions of the Drive Tool and other EC updates, you can sign up for the EC newsletter at electrificationcoalition.org at the bottom of the website. Next, getting into the impact the Drive Tool has made, the title of the webinar shows a guiding light the drive tool has been. In addition, it is a critical driver in fleet electrification with over 1 million vehicles assessed, over 2,000 fleets assessed, over 40 appearances at events, webinars included, and over 16 new features added as we get more feedback from folks just like you. And as we approach 2 million vehicles assessed by the drive tool, again, from folks just like you, we're projected to make this goal by the end of the year as word spreads about the tool and as improvements continue. And now for the big 2.0 update. What does it include? Not only are there major updates like a better user experience, one example of that is being able to more transparently see the inputs you are inputting on the dashboard, but also more medium and heavy duty vehicle options, EVs, and a brand new charging infrastructure planning dashboard. But there are also dozens of other minor quality of life improvements and more to come. And now, as we approach the walkthrough section, joining me is Spencer Burgett, our developer at Atlas Public Policy and my partner in crime for improving the tool. Spencer, please take it away.
Hi, Steph. Thank you so much for having us. I'm Spencer Burgett. I'm a policy analyst with Atlas Public Policy. We're a policy tech firm based in DC that's been around since 2015. And we, as Steph mentioned, started developing the DRVE tool, or the precursor to the DRVE tool, back in 2019 to really fill the need that we were seeing to provide data-driven insights to fleet managers to make the case for electrification. In addition to the DRVE tool, we do a lot of work with nonprofits, government agencies, and industry players in transportation electrification. That really helps us stay up to speed with everything going on in the industry so we can provide the most accurate and up-to-date information into the DRVE tool so we're working with accurate inputs. And today I'm going to be walking through a full fleet analysis demo with the DRVE tool to show off and talk through all of the new features, and then we'll be happy to field questions afterwards. So we can go ahead and bring up the screen share. We will walk through the tool. So here is the new DRVE 2.0 interface. As Steph mentioned, it's a real priority for 2.0 to bring DRVE into 2024 with a new modern interface that's a lot easier to use and a lot more transparent for folks as you're stepping through the analysis, that it really guides you step by step through what needs to happen. So this is the main interface. On the left-hand side, you're gonna be able to keep track of your progress through the analysis, as well as some helpful links to learn more through a new and updated comprehensive user guide, as well as links to both our website and the Electrification Coalition's website to reach out. We're always really happy to help folks. Similar options as the previous tool to save your fleet and save your progress as you step through the tool. As you can see from the start, you can either start brand new from a new fleet, or if you've run a previous analysis, you can start up with a fleet that's already been processed. We're going to go from scratch today so we can really demonstrate the full capabilities of the tool. So again, like Steph said, the whole basis of the tool is starting from fleet data, specifically vehicle identification numbers. So you want to start with a list of all of the vehicle identification numbers in your fleet. I've prepared some sample data that has 100 odd vehicles. I'm going to go ahead and open up here. I've selected the file that contains those vehicle identification numbers. In addition, it's going to have the annual vehicle miles traveled and the expected years of use for each vehicle. The next couple steps are to guide through choosing the where that data lives on the sheet. So here in that input data workbook, the sheet is called sample data. And there's a column in that sheet it's called VIN, that has the vehicle identification numbers. Once I've told the tool where those vehicle identification numbers live, it's going to prompt me for three other vehicle level inputs, one of which is the years of use column. So this is really important for vehicle electrification analyses because it's going to affect how long the vehicle is operating, and so how long you have to realize fuel and maintenance cost savings. So you have the option to either use a default if you might not have that available in your fleet data, or in this case, we do have that, and that vehicle, that column is called useful life. So I'm selecting the useful life column. And then similarly, annual VMT or annual vehicle miles traveled is a key input, key factor determining the electrification potential of vehicles, because it determines, if you're driving more miles, you can have bigger opportunities for maintenance and fuel cost savings. So similarly, I'm going to select annual VMT, which is in my fleet data. So this next input is a new one with DRVE 2.0. We heard a lot of feedback on DRVE 1.0 and through our other work with fleets that charging infrastructure deployment is proving to be a really significant challenge facing fleet managers. And so we wanted to adapt the DRVE tool to better support fleet managers who are trying to plan out their charging infrastructure, how they're going to actually deliver electricity to these EVs that they're purchasing. And so we've added, as part of that update, which we're going to get more into later, we've added an additional optional input to add the location where a vehicle is domiciled. And so this, it doesn't have to be a formal address. This can be, Depot A, Depot B, Depot C. It's really all about being able to then, once we've run the analysis, say, where are these EVs that are showing cost saving potential located, so that I can then plan my infrastructure. If all my depot, all my vehicles at Depot C look like really great candidates for electrification, I should probably be thinking about installing charging infrastructure there. So I'm gonna go ahead and select the location column there because I do wanna use it. And then lastly is the fleet zip code. This is really critical because the tool uses the fleet zip code to tailor the inputs of the analysis to specific local characteristics. So for example, fuel prices are gonna be based on fuel prices in the state where the fleet is located. In addition, electricity emissions are going to be due to customized based on the electric grid where the fleet's located. If your fleet's located across multiple zips, it's okay to sort of choose one representative zip because those inputs are really, the zip code's going to be mapped to the state and then is also going to be mapped to an electricity grid region. There's not perfect overlap between the two, which is why we ask for a zip code here and not just state. So I'm gonna go ahead and run with a zip code near and dear to my heart where my mom grew up in Aurora, Colorado. And you're gonna see when I enter that zip code that this button to apply state incentives has lit up blue, where we actually in the background of Drive have a comprehensive database of state level incentives for EVs that can then be automatically applied through the analysis. So that's a good sign that popped up. And I'm gonna go ahead and see what options are available there. And you can see that there is a Colorado electric vehicle tax credit available in that state. If I want to learn more, here's a link to go see if I qualify, learn more about the specific eligibilities. I'm going to go ahead and add that into the analysis. You'll see that that pops on into the right, meaning that that's going to be included in the analysis. I'm going to go ahead and save those settings. So this looks like I'm all set on the fleet import. You can see on the left step where I just finished that fleet import step. And so I'm going to click next to proceed to the next step. So at this point, what the tool does is it's taking all of the VINs from the sample fleet or from your fleet data. And it's gonna run those VINs through an online VIN decoder maintained by the Federal Highway Administration to determine the make, the model, and the type of vehicle so that we know which vehicles are actually in the fleet. In this case, we have about 100 vehicles, but there's only 14 distinct vehicle types or distinct VIN keys, which is what tells you the make, the model, and the type of vehicle. Here on the right, you can see all of those vehicles popping up. It looks like all 100 of my vehicles decoded correctly. If you had some errors in the VINs or a weird edge case VIN that might have gotten dropped, there's an option to fix those dropped VINs, which just means you tell the tool, I know that this VIN is a Ford F-150 or a Chevy Colorado. You can see all the vehicles found in the fleet. Once that looks good, I can go ahead and go to the next step, which is going to be our fleet mapping step. So the way that the Drive tool works, once it's figured out what all the vehicles are in your fleet, which you can see on the left, so you can see I have 5 Toyota Corollas, 11 Ford Tauruses, 15 Chevy Silverados in my fleet. The tool is going to map all of those vehicles to a potential ICE replacement and then a potential EV replacement. So in this case, the tool selected a Toyota Corolla Gas as a potential replacement for the Toyota Corollas in the fleet. And then it selected as an electric alternative, a Tesla Model 3. Built into the tool is also all of the vehicle specifications that are required to complete a fleet analysis. That would be the price, the fuel economy, and then any incentives that are available. You can see for the Tesla that it qualifies for a $5,000 incentive in the state of Colorado. That's going to be from that the state incentive that I applied in the previous step, which has logic built in based on the type of vehicle, the MSRP, the range, the battery size. It calculates the estimated incentive amount from that program that I applied. But let's say I'm a fleet manager and I, you know, have a mandate against buying Teslas, or I don't have a contact at Tesla. And so this doesn't seem like a viable alternative to me. I can go ahead and edit that mapping. And maybe instead of that Tesla Model 3, I'm interested in maybe a Nissan Leaf. Maybe I have a good deal at a local Nissan dealership. You can see as part of Drive 2.0, we've really increased the size of the vehicles covered in the database. So where before we really had a few core options, you can really see pretty comprehensive coverage of both currently available as well as some upcoming vehicles. The way this is going to go is that stepping through these lists is going to filter the ones below to narrow down to a valid fleet vehicle. So if I go ahead and say, I want to work with, you know, I have a Nissan dealership, I'm going to work with a Nissan replacement. When I come down to the model option, I'm going to be able to see all of the different Nissan EVs that are available in the tool, down to the actual specific trims in those vehicles. So for example, for the Nissan Ariya, you can see I can go with the bigger battery, I can go with the smaller battery, I can go with four-wheel drive, I can go with just front-wheel drive. For the Leaf, a few less options available, I'm gonna go ahead and choose just that base Nissan Leaf. You can see the tool has built in MSRP, fuel economy, and then again, that incentive value for any of those vehicles that you choose, and that auto populates here. Looks like that Nissan Leaf comes in just over 28,000. It's going to, by default, choose the most latest vehicle available, but we might also have options if I wanted to check out the 2023 Leaf instead to see if there were deals there. The use case, I don't recommend messing with, but if you wanted to kind of assign a different use case, you're able to modify that here. But that's going to auto-populate to a car. As part of Drive 2.0, we really redid all of the vehicle use cases to make it much more intuitive. These use cases are really used, A, to assign the state incentives that you just saw, because a lot of incentive programs have different incentive values or requirements based on the type of the vehicle. And then they're also used to assign some of the default charging infrastructure needs for the vehicle. And then finally, they're used in the results to view the results. So you can see the electrification potential of the cars in your fleet, of the SUVs in your fleet, of the pickups in your fleet. And so that's going to be a lot more useful and fine-tuned, having sort of reworked those use cases, working with different folks in the industry. Once I'm happy with this Nissan Leaf selection, I'm going to go ahead and select Update Vehicle Mapping, which is going to then give me a notification that it was updated successfully. And you're going to see the Nissan Leaf is now showing up here as that replacement option for the Toyota Corolla. So I can step through the rest of these vehicles to make sure they look good. You can also, even if I don't want to change the mapping, for example, you can change the vehicle specifications. So let's say I just got a quote here. You can see the Chevy Colorado, we're modeling replacing it with the Ford Lightning. Let's look at the Silverado instead, actually. You can see you're modeling it, replacing it with the Ford Lightning. Let's say I just got a quote and that's coming in more like 52,000 than 49,000. I can go ahead and edit it, and I can leave the vehicle the same, but just update the vehicle specs. So I'm going to go ahead and change that. Maybe that's now looking like 52,500. And I'm going to go ahead and update that. And that's going to go ahead and update that price for that Ford Lightning. Maybe also I'm in Colorado. Maybe I need this Chevy Silverado to be four-wheel drive instead of two-wheel drive. I might go ahead and leave other pieces the same, but swap this out for a four-wheel drive Silverado, and we're going to see the MSRP and the fuel economy update accordingly. Once I've gone through the fleet and I'm happy with all of those vehicle mappings, I can save the process fleet. That's going to generate an Excel file that I can import into the tool so that next time I don't have to go through the process of decoding and mapping the fleet, and I can just pick up right here. But I've saved it. Next option is to move into configuring the rest of the analysis level settings. Go ahead and click next. And you can see we've now, on the left-hand side, if you're tracking our steps, we've imported our fleet, we've mapped our fleet, and now we're setting up the model settings. The model settings, I think when we decided to scope out Drive 2.0, a lot of the feedback that we heard on the model settings was that there's a huge variety and a huge span of users and their behaviors with the model settings, in terms of there are some users that really want to be able to customize every single setting and spend half an hour really customizing all these settings and details. And there's other users that just sort of want a quicker, faster analysis. Maybe they want to change a gas price and then get going. And so we've really made this much of a more choose your own adventure and tailor it to your own needs, where we have, first off, the ability to just go ahead and run the analysis right from the jump. The version 1.0, every user had to step through every settings page, which could sort of slow down your analysis. Now, if you want to just go ahead and run the analysis on all default settings, that's one click. Go run our analysis. At the same time, you have the option to jump into any of these different settings that you would like. We've reorganized them into 6 core groups that you see on the screen that goes from market factors to charging infrastructure to charging strategy to procurement strategy to maintenance and insurance to forecasting. And so you can customize as many of these or as little of these as you like. I'm going to go ahead and step through all of them and explain a little bit about them as we're doing this analysis. Starting out with market factors, this is really describing general market conditions that are impacting your fleet electrification journey. That includes fuel prices, specifically gas and diesel, as well as the inflation rate. The discount rate, which we can get into a little more later, but is around the how net present value is calculated. And then also the cost of carbon for fleets that are interested in including the social cost of carbon. So like I said earlier, these gas and diesel prices are going to load in based on the zip code that you entered earlier in the analysis. So these are going to be customized to my location in Colorado, based on data from the U.S. Energy Information Administration, EIA. But I might be a fleet that has a good deal with a fuel provider. And so let's say this actually looks a little bit high and I want to edit it. I can go ahead and edit those settings. And let's say maybe I can get gas for $3.50 with the contract I just signed and my diesel is coming in at $4.25. We can go ahead and load that. And I'm gonna also rename that scenario while I'm here, since that's no longer the default. I'm gonna call that maybe my baseline scenario. I'll click save, and that's gonna overwrite our gasoline price and our diesel price. I might also be worried about sensitivities to either increasing or decreasing gas prices. Let's say maybe I also wanted to see in the end results a high case analysis in case diesel prices or gas prices are higher than I expected. Maybe I'll throw in a 4 and a 475 diesel price as a high scenario. Once I've entered those here, I can go ahead and hit add, and that's gonna add a second fuel price scenario to the analysis. This is a good opportunity to talk about one of the coolest features about Drive that existed in the first version, but is a lot more usable and functional in this second version, which is scenario analysis. So as you can see here, I've entered 2 gasoline prices and 2 diesel prices, or a baseline and a high fuel price scenario. And what the tool is able to do is actually run through every vehicle procurement in the analysis with under both the baseline and the high fuel price scenario to enable you to view what the total cost of ownership looks like under the baseline scenario, as well as what it looks like under the high scenario. And that's gonna be able, when you're viewing the results, you'll have options to toggle between the two and look at the average savings, the cost per mile, and the likelihood of electrification under each of those scenarios. There's a few other opportunities in the tool where we can also set that kind of scenario analysis. But yeah, inflationary discount rate, cost of carbon, I'm gonna go ahead and leave those alone, and we're just gonna close out of this market factors settings. One of the other settings groupings that we really almost completely reworked for Drive 2.0 was around charging infrastructure. So this is our new charging infrastructure page. Again, we really heard from fleets that this is really top priority for them of understanding how the cost of charging infrastructure is going to influence their transition to EVs and their cost of ownership. So what you're seeing here is a charging infrastructure costs tied to each of the different vehicle use cases in the analysis. So on the right, you have the 12 unique vehicle use cases in Drive that we saw earlier. So that's your car, SUV, minivan, et cetera. And each of those is mapped to a type of charging. So in this case, we've mapped these four light duty use cases. So your car, SUV, minivan, light pickup to a relatively low powered level two charger. We're saying that the charging ratio is there's one vehicle for every level two port. And then we've loaded in default costs based on a national infrastructure assessment that Atlas conducted last year and that we keep updated in terms of understanding across the country what we're seeing as average costs for charging deployment. That being said, there's huge variation from fleet to fleet. So it's really highly recommended that fleet managers assess the costs facing their depots and customize the analysis based on their own both upfront and annual maintenance and networking costs. So this works similar to the fuel price scenarios that we saw earlier, where you can go ahead and view all of the inputs here. And if I want to edit that, I can, with that scenario selected, edit it. I can use this table to change the use cases it applies to. Only thing to be careful of is to ensure that all of the use cases are mapped to only one type of charging. So if I added cargo van here, I would want to remove it from the other scenario where we're seeing it. More commonly, it's going to be really helpful to be able to change the costs and maybe the port type or the charging ratio for these. So for example, I might think that, I know my fleet manager and we have a lot of people on hand to shuffle vehicles around. So I think that we can get away with actually charging two vehicles for each level two port that we have here. Upfront costs look good, but maybe I have state or local, I think my local electric utility offers a $250 credit towards level two stations. So I'm gonna actually add a local incentive. This was a much requested feature as we've seen incentives for charging infrastructure really proliferate since we launched the first tool. Another major development we saw recently was the 30C tax credit for alternative fuel vehicle refueling infrastructure. This tax credit is limited to certain census tracts. And so what we've done is we've included the option to include the credit and a link to check eligibility for where your fleet depots are located. The credit has a base value of 6%, but if the charging installation meet certain prevailing wage and apprenticeship requirements, it can go up to 30%. So it's a relatively complicated credit, but it is potentially covering up to 30% of the cost of your charging infrastructure. So we thought it was really important to include, but really to give users discretion on if they want to include it, and then if they also want to include those wage and apprenticeship bonuses. I do have to say that Atlas and the EC are not tax experts. This is not legal or financial advice. It's just helping model if you do qualify for those credits, how that could affect the total cost of ownership. So let's say I've added my credit. Maybe my depots don't fall within those eligible census tracts. So I'm just gonna go ahead and leave it at there. I can go ahead and save that scenario. Now I step through the other ones. You can see we have, we're using slightly more high powered charging for our cargo vans, our medium duty pickups, and our shuttle buses. I might want to also add that $250 credit for my local utility for those level two chargers. Then you can see get little heavier duty trucks. We have our step vans, our medium duty straight trucks, and our school buses. And those we have mapped to even more high powered 80 amp level two charging. I might still want to add that $250 credit here. You also see at the bottom, we have the option to either purchase charging infrastructures up front with cash or loan options. Here, I'm just gonna go ahead and stick with a cash purchase. Just for reference, all of these mappings were done based on, again, that national infrastructure assessment where we looked at average energy use needs across the country for an electric step van, for an electric, you know, any of these. For example, the results of that analysis showed that on average across the country, electric step vans can generally be served by 80 amp level two charger. At the same time, that's going to depend a lot depending on how that vehicle is being used. And so we really do recommend fleets to understand the energy use and the charging that's required for their fleet and really use these defaults as a baseline. The tool, when we get to the results, is going to show both the costs with and without charging infrastructure. So even if you know you're not really thinking about including charging infrastructure, it's helpful to have this these settings available so that you can take a look at what that might mean for the analysis. Buses, straight trucks, tractors are all mapped to DCFC. We're going to go ahead and leave those as is and save our charging infrastructure settings. The next step would be to poke at charging strategy. So this is really about, we kind of set our depot charging infrastructure upfront costs here. Charging strategy is really about the cost of electricity for charging the vehicles. There's less settings here, but they are really important and they allow users to decide the split between charging at the depot, where the electricity price is the average residential or average commercial electricity price in their area, charging in public, that would be at kind of publicly available charging stations, or charging en route if the fleet has specific chargers along their vehicle operations that might have a different charging price. Here, I like this scenario, but maybe my fleet's considering the impacts of including some public charging. And I want to add a new scenario that maybe does, maybe 90% of the charging happens at the depot, but we're going to have 10% happen at public chargers. The tool will stop you from doing it, but these numbers have to add up to 100% so that your vehicles are being fully charged. For public charging, you see two additional settings where the tool is capturing the cost of labor for waiting at public chargers. So if you include public charging, we're looking at, we'll model how long the vehicles are actually have to be there charging and how much that labor, that driver labor costs while they're there. You can adjust for those settings, both the max power that affects how long they have to charge and the labor cost per hour. I might call this one public so that we have a second charging strategy scenario and go ahead and save that. And then I might rename this strategy depot so that I know how they're different. Go ahead and call that one depot. So you can see I have two different charging strategies we're going to model, as well as those two different fuel prices that we're modeling. One that has 10% charging in public and one that has 100% charging at the depot. The next setting is going to be procurement strategy. So this is really how the vehicles are purchased. By default, it's set to a cash purchase, but we do support a number of other purchase structures. If I want to go ahead and edit our default scenario, I can see that long list, either a loan or a number of different lease purchase structures. If you select one of those, we're going to have all of the specific lease terms and interest rates pop up. For the purpose of this analysis, I'm going to stick to a cash purchase, which is generally most common. Regardless of your ownership strategy, there's three important tax settings related to the vehicle procurements. One is if you're able to monetize the federal tax credit. So one thing that we added to this tool is the new and updated federal vehicle, commercial vehicle tax credit. That's up to $7,500 for light duty vehicles, and it can go up to $40,000 for medium heavy duty vehicles. That's going to be automatically applied based on the type of the vehicle. That's a direct pay credit, so that's almost always going to be good to include, but we did want to give folks the option to not include it in case they're in a rare situation where it wasn't available. Maybe their prices, if they've already taken into account those tax credits. In addition, we've added sales tax. We've heard that that's a non-negligible expense for many fleets. It's customized based on the state where you are, but can be adjusted based on potentially local taxes or other initial taxes you might be facing. And then lastly, we've added the federal excise tax on heavy duty trucks. That's 12%. That applies only to the tractor, the really heavy duty truck use case. If that all looks good, I'll go ahead and close out of that procurement strategy and get through our last two settings. First one is maintenance and insurance. This has a new look, but functions pretty much the same as it used to, where you're able to set maintenance and insurance costs for across passenger vehicles, across medium duty vehicles, and across heavy duty vehicles, with defaults loaded in from the latest research from the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. These can be edited just by changing the cell. So maybe I have a better deal on insurance for light duty vehicles. That's actually the same across all the fuel types. And I might just change all of those light duty insurance costs to $600 per vehicle. We can go ahead and save that. And then the final setting grouping is forecasting. This is more of an advanced setting for fleet managers that looks at procurements made in the future. So by default, the tool is gonna use current vehicle prices, current market conditions, and then is gonna adjust those over the use of the vehicle. So it's gonna take into account energy inflation and inflation of maintenance and insurance costs. But we also have the option to project what total cost of ownership might look like into the future, which is helpful as fleets look about kind of procurement down the line. So I probably want to keep the default forecast just to understand what it looks like today, but I might also be interested in seeing what it looks like into the future. So that could look like 2025, 2030, all the way out to 2050. 2030 might make sense here as a newer term scenario. So when we're forecasting, it's important to take in mind that what the tool is really doing is it's using published literature, in this case from Argonne National Laboratory, on projected changes in vehicle prices, fuel economy, and energy prices over time. So we're expecting over time with continued battery cost declines for the cost of electric vehicles to go down. And then as fuel economy standards continue to ramp up, we're expecting both the price and the fuel economy of fossil fuel powered vehicles to increase over time. That being said, there's some uncertainty of that. And so there's two kind of scenarios included. There's a low technology progress and a high technology progress scenario that are described here, where the high technology progress sees faster improvements and faster price declines for EVs. For this case, we're going to use the low technology progress or more business as usual scenario. Lastly, I'm going to rename this. I'm just going to call it 2030 low and go ahead and save that scenario. On the left, you'll see we now have that default forecast representing current conditions, and then the 2030 low scenario reflecting future conditions for vehicles bought in 2030. Go ahead and save that. And we now have set and gone through all six settings. This was a bit of a more in-depth analysis than everybody might do, but we really wanted to show the full capabilities of the tool to customize and even add scenario analysis across all of these different potential factors in the total cost of ownership. This is another checkpoint where you can go ahead and export those analysis settings, which is going to just save everything that I just set here into a separate Excel file that can then be imported into a later analysis to facilitate to really run through it quickly. Maybe I had a different fleet or a different set of vehicles that I want to run through with all of the same settings. I can load that fleet in and just import those settings. Once I'm ready and happy with all my settings, I'm going to go ahead and hit run analysis, which is going to run through all of the different vehicles and scenarios that I just set up. The timing for this analysis is going to depend on how many vehicles I have and how many scenarios I have. It's also going to be a little bit slower if you're screen sharing on a webinar. So be a little patient as this runs, because this is a fairly computer resource intensive process. While it's running, I want to talk quickly about kind of scenario analysis and how that's going to impact the complexity and the time that the analysis takes. So the as we're going through the tool, you saw that we started out with 100 vehicles. Here you can see we're running 2,000 scenarios. So that's basically a factor of how many different scenarios we've added to the tool and how many individual procurements we have to run. So here we're running 2,000 individual procurements and individual total cost of ownership analyses. And that's because for every vehicle, we have one conventional ICE vehicle to run, and then we have one electric scenario to run. And then that's further multiplied by, we set, two fuel price scenarios where we have the baseline and the high fuel price. And so every gas vehicle, every gas procurement, we're now going to run twice, once with the low and once with the high. Then we set multiple charging strategies. So every electric vehicle is going to be run with both the public and the depot charging scenario. Then when you start forecasting, we've just doubled. We're running all of those scenarios we just set up, but we're running them both today and in 2030. So as you start kind of multiplying those scenarios, you can see how I very quickly turned a fleet of 100 vehicles into 200 individual scenarios. So this tool technically could support up to 1 million scenarios. That would be incredibly, incredibly slow. We've run successful analyses in the 40,000 to 60,000 range, and I've seen people even pushing 100,000, depending on, again, your computer specifications and fleet size. And so just to recommend folks to, if needed, you can split your fleet up and run multiple analyses. You can run, the 2023 at once and then run the 2030 later. A lot of different options to really analyze the full fleet. You can see, this is going to take about 2.5 minutes to run through with 2,000 scenarios. So it can take, it's going to add time the more scenarios that you add. That's also a little slower. It's going to depend on your computer resources available. And again, my computer spending some energy screen sharing and being on the webinar. And so if you're just running Drive Tool, which I usually recommend when you're doing analysis, you can move through it way faster. Finally, once this pops up, we're going to be able to load those analysis results into our dashboard and check them out. This again takes a little bit of time. And I think while we wait for these to pop up, we're going to bring Steph back on to share a little bit more about our process for developing this tool. Hi, Steph. Yeah. Welcome back. Give me a break to get some water. That was a lot to get through quickly.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. And please do take some water as well. Yeah. So, how this started out in development for 2.0 is that First, we put out a survey to see if anyone's interested in being involved in our stakeholder engagement groups. And then from there, we were able to set the context in three different meetings. So first one was really getting an idea of the context and what exactly was the drive tool to begin with? How do we want to steer it? What type of feedback are we getting? Second meeting was taking all of that survey feedback that we had received from cities, private fleets, all, you name it, and then turning that in the third meeting into a draft of what you are seeing today and incorporating those final feedback moments. And then from our end on Atlas and EC side, we were able to really test out the beta version and make sure everything was good to go for you all to see today. And through all that, I commend the work of Atlas and the EC folks. It's been quite a journey ever since I think September, somewhere around that of last year. And up until now, it's been a good journey.
Yeah, it's been, I was just thinking, I think it's been almost a year in the making. So we're really, again, so excited to get this out there. And really appreciative of all of the folks who've provided feedback, both through our focus group and through all of the emails and chats and people we've connected with since we launched Drive, many of whom I'm sure are on the call today. So we definitely look forward to hearing your feedback on 2.0 and are really excited to get you all, you know, using it and exploring it and providing feedback.
Yeah, and it's hard to believe that, you know, this is a process that we started. It was just a concise TCO calculator back in 2020, just an idea after a conference, right? Yeah, and
it famously started over a beer at the fourth roadmap conference, I believe.
that's it right there. Yeah. And from there we were able to bring it out to cities, gain more of those features that cities particularly use, those public governments, public fleets in particular, and from there really make it something that everyone and anyone can use. And so with that said, Atlas Public Policy and the EC, we definitely will continue taking questions and feedback on the Drive tool going on. I will definitely look forward to hearing feedback on how 2.0 is, especially managing it on my end. And it's been quite a time. And more to come for sure, especially as more folks are using it as we approach 2 million people, or rather 2 million vehicles assessed, especially. Okay.
Thanks, Steph. I'm going to go ahead and pull up existing results. The tool is being a little slow loading results while on the webinar. So we can go ahead and walk through the new results dashboard here. Let's get that screen share up here momentarily. And I think that should be ready to show. Thanks everybody for your patience. Great, so this is our new results dashboard that has really received a complete facelift. I think we heard from a lot of folks some challenges with kind of the technical complexity of the previous results, and then B, the transparency on what's been modeled and how we're sort of arriving at some of these end numbers. And so that's really the main principles we had in mind while revamping this results view. And so I started with a landing dashboard that really presents the 1,000-foot view. That's really great to, you know, get a high-level sense of what does electrification look like for this fleet, and then also to share, you know, with other folks where we heard a lot of people using these results, you know, beyond just the really technical fleet people that are in the weeds and wanting to kind of share those results in a more summarized form externally. So you're seeing here is we've broken down the vehicle's results into three categories. So we have vehicles that are demonstrating EV savings, where we're seeing the electric vehicle over the total lifetime of the vehicle showing at least 5% or more savings compared to the ICE or gasoline diesel replacement. Then we have cost parity. So these would be vehicles that are really too close to call that come down to within 5%, either greater than or less than the total cost of ownership of the ICE vehicle. And then finally, we have vehicles with EV costs. So these would be vehicles where the electric vehicle over the total cost of ownership costs more than 5% more than the ICE vehicle. For this fleet, you can see that we had a fleet of 100 vehicles, we had about 41% of vehicles show EV savings, 28 show cost parity, and then 31 vehicles where EV was more expensive than the ICE alternative. Have high level summaries here that comes down to about 70%, a little under 70% of the fleet showing either savings or cost parity. Then we're also looking at totaling up the total lifetime savings of those vehicles with EV savings or cost parity. So saying if you electrified those vehicles that make sense to electrify, the fleet could save $176,000 over the lifetime of those vehicles. Before I go down here, you're also gonna see on the right our inputs dashboard. So when you talk about transparency, this was really important for us to show the, what's actually driving these results, and then also to give users the option to dive in and customize those results. So before, this kind of required a more in-depth knowledge if you had, set multiple gas prices or different charging strategies. Now, those are all going to appear as easy-to-use slicers on this right-hand side that are then going to impact everything else on the tool. So here, unfortunately, this doesn't reflect the scenarios that we just set in the inputs, but it would show, the two different fuel prices we had just set and the two different charging strategies we set. What every analysis will show is both including or excluding the cost of charging infrastructure. This is often a tough decision for fleets, depending on kind of how they budget for fleet procurements and how they consider total cost of ownership. And so we wanted to make sure that all fleets had the option to either include or exclude that, just to view both. So the way that this works is if I wanted to see all the results with the cost of infrastructure, I could switch this over to yes, and it's gonna update and show us all of those results now, including the cost of charging infrastructure once it loads here. So now you can see that we have about 24% of the fleet with EV savings or cost parity. And we're not seeing any lifetime savings. So we've seen that really including those higher upfront costs really shifts a lot of the vehicles towards cost parity or towards EV costs, which is, speaks to how important it is to include that charging infrastructure. Go ahead and switch that back to no, and you'll see that our results have all updated, not only on the dashboard, but across all the other pages of results. To reflect that those new changes. There's also better transparency here on the inputs where you can, I've done it before, I'm sure other folks have done it, forgot the gas price that we set for the analysis or forgot the charging costs we set. And so those are now displayed right here, easy to track. So you can really see what's driving that analysis. If you scroll down the results dashboard, we have those vehicles broken down by vehicle class. You can see that the light duty vehicles are really the ones that are showing EV savings or cost parity, while on the medium and heavy duty side, most of those are all of those actually in this analysis are showing EV costs. And then further down, we can see actually the top models to procure. So this is looking at which specific modeled procurements are showing the most promising EV savings. Here you can see our top one would be switching out our Ford Explorer with Kia EV9, where we have 21 Ford Explorers in the fleet that could be replaced with a Kia EV9, either showing savings or at cost parity. Promising vehicles across the board, we have a Ford Lightning showing savings, Pacifica Hybrid, Mustang Mach-E, and then that Tesla Model 3. So that's really the landing dashboard. From here, you can see we have a few options. Down the bottom, we can really get more in depth with those results. At the top, we can export and save them. So we can either save the results and save this Excel workbook directly, or we can generate a PDF report written summary. That's great for sort of executive level summary of what the analysis showed. Dive a little more in. I'm going to start actually with a new view, which is our charging infrastructure needs view, which was really exciting. I talked a little bit earlier about the ways that we've prioritized and implemented a focus on charging infrastructure. And so this is where you can see the locations that you set way back at the fleet import step being really important. So what this is showing is it's showing the number of charging ports across each location that was included in the fleet import. And it's broken down by the savings potential of the vehicle. So here you can see at location one, where for electrifying all of the vehicles, we're gonna need 15 low powered level twos, a couple, you know, mid-powered ECFC, and then a few higher-powered L2s. Whereas if we're just focused on those vehicles that are showing high levels of EV savings, we're going to have fewer of those. And you can see that across all four locations mentioned in the fleet. Again, this is really just used to group the charging infrastructure. We're not, you know, trying to map this because we know fleets might not have the ability to share their, you know, specific depot location information. So it's really intended to capture, you know, just the location name. Down here, then, we have all of the estimated costs and the ports in tabular form. So we can see the same data down here for each location, the number of ports needed. And then we have the costs, estimated upfront costs, by station, and then total, and then we have the estimated annual maintenance costs by station, and then again, total across all of the stations that are going to be installed at that location. We also use these slicers at the top to further narrow down if we wanted to look at, you know, just the charging for heavy-duty vehicles. That's going to be those heavier DCFC ports. You can clear that out, check it out by our use cases as well if you would like. So we're really excited about this tool as a way to help fleets start to get a handle around how much charging infrastructure their fleet is actually going to need under these different scenarios, and then how much that might cost both at an upfront and an annual basis. Other pieces we'd want to look at would be our vehicle summary. So this is this was in the previous tool, but has been revamped a little bit, again, to provide more transparency through what we're looking at. So this is, you know, a more detailed, maybe a little bit less executive-friendly view, but where we can really get in-depth on the specific vehicles in the fleet and what sorts of, how many vehicles there are at the count, and then both the electric and conventional total lifetime costs, as well as over here, their cost per miles. And then you're seeing here the savings or costs in the case that the electric vehicle is more expensive than the ICE replacement. We've gone a step further. I think what we really heard was there's a need both for higher level summary views, which we addressed with that, you know, pretty dashboard, but also for a little more granular, in-depth views of how each vehicle breaks down. And so that's where we've added a new results view, which we're calling the cost breakdown, where we can look on a kind of vehicle by vehicle basis at what's driving the savings or the cost that we're seeing at that high level. So we can just run through an example here if we want to see this, the Ford or the Toyota Corolla in the fleet. You can see that we have five of those, and that we have on top here, the conventional vehicles modeled. So in this case, we're modeling replacing that with a 2024 Toyota Corolla. And then alternatively, we're modeling replacing it with a Tesla Model 3. Here you can see the incentives that have been applied. So we have the average federal incentive and then state incentives that have been applied. In this case, we included the $7,500 federal tax incentive. And then we can get down into the detailed cost per mile. So you can here you can see that the conventional Toyota Corolla has a lower depreciation cost. That's sort of the upfront cost minus the resale value of the vehicle at the end of its expected years of use. We modeled cash purchases, so neither of them had a financing cost associated. You can see the Tesla Model 3 saves about 6 cents per mile on fuel, and then it saves about 4 cents per mile on maintenance. In this inputs right now, we're not including charging infrastructure, so that's gonna be zero for each. But if we modify those inputs to include charging infrastructure, we would see that the per mile cost of charging infrastructure connected to the Model 3. And then we have those that upfront sales tax here that's accounting for about 1 cent per mile. And then you can see the total cost added up across all of these different cost components comes to about 3 cents per mile savings for that Tesla Model 3, where we have the fuel cost and the maintenance cost savings making up for a little bit more expensive upfront costs related to that depreciation cost. The final piece, I know we're getting over time, would be on emissions, where we've really integrated the built-in emissions model and drive, where previously we were just using that to identify and incorporate the cost of carbon. Now have the ability to explore the potential impacts of electrification on your fleet's emissions. So here is where we can see the, based on the original fleet vehicle, you can see the CO2 emissions of replacing it with an EV here, compared to replacing it with an ICE, and then those potential reductions on a per vehicle basis. So every Toyota Corolla in this fleet that we electrify, we're gonna see an average of 3 tons of CO2 reduced per year. Same thing for NOx emissions, PM2.5 emissions as well. So really round out the set of emissions that we're worried about. That's about it. We're so excited about this launch and feel to get your hands on it. Like Steph said, we're really excited also to hear your feedback. We've developed this, with you all in mind and through focus groups, but there's always more that we can do. And so definitely be in touch with all of us. And I think we're now gonna shift back over to questions and happy to dive deeper into anything that's come up for you all.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you so much, Spencer, for that very thorough walkthrough. And we can get started with the first Q&A question, which is, first one on my list here is, how often are VINs updated? How often are vehicle prices updated? Are there MSRP, are the MSRPs updated in real time? And if I can take a first stab at this, VINs, as mentioned before, it's all on Federal Highway Administration's database, or NHTSA specifically. And so because of that, and since it's typically updated online, you have that feature of having it real time. As for vehicle pricing, we do that, we check on them quarterly or bi-quarterly basis in a sense, just to make sure that the base MSRPs are accurate, if I recall correctly, right, Spencer?
Yeah, that's right. We have taken a little pause while we're developing Drive 2.0, but going forward, we're gonna be implementing quarterly updates to all of that underlying vehicle data, including bringing in new upcoming vehicles as they're announced, as we learn more about them. So we're really excited about, now that we have 2.0 out, keeping that vehicle as well as our fuel price and all those other inputs that you saw us walk through, keeping those up to date on a regular basis.
Right. Thank you for that. And We can then move on to the second question. When editing the baseline replacement of an electric alternative vehicle, how does this person make sure it saves replacements they added? And for that, I'll say, this probably was a question that was really early on before we got to it, but at whenever you make edits to any of the replacement models, baseline or electric, there will be a box that comes up for updating or saving that exactly. So nothing gets lost for that.
Yeah, if I could jump in, this is actually something feedback we heard on the first version that we've really addressed with this new version, where we had in the previous version, you had you're editing the vehicle specifications, and then if you didn't on that page click a kind of update mapping, you would, and you went to the next vehicle, that would not save the settings. We've changed that, hopefully, as you saw in the inputs, where that now editing vehicle settings is a separate pop-up window. So you'll actually have to save it in order to close that window, which will mean that it should be much more clear now that you've saved those settings and you won't really have the ability to move on to the next vehicle without having saved the changes you made to the vehicle. So I'm glad that came up because that was something we were very happy to address with this new version.
Yeah, I remember that coming up, and I, for one, was excited for that update as well. So next question, has the tool been updated to better represent options for class 4 through 8 vehicles? We have added a lot more of the medium and heavy duty fleets, EVs in particular, so good news for that.
Yeah, I can speak a little bit to our process there. We've spent a lot of effort over the past year or so combing through better data on medium and heavy duty vehicles. I think the biggest challenge in the class 4 to 8 space is that all of that vehicle's data is manually collected data because we don't have a public source. We don't have what the EPA does for light duty vehicles, which is compile and require automakers to test fuel economy and compile MSRPs. And you can't go on Freightliner's website and see what a Cascadia costs. So what we've sourced is on the EV side, we've seen a huge growth recently in state procurement contracts, including with the federal government, where we have states putting out to bid electric heavy duty trucks. And so we have all of this great data from what different dealerships and manufacturers have bid to states on, you know, how much it would cost the state to procure a electric school bus, electric transit bus, electric heavy duty truck. Those just didn't exist, honestly, when we launched the first version of the tool. So that's been a great resource where we've been able to use real world electric prices for class 4 to 8 vehicles. On the ICE side, we've done a lot of work researching truck marketplaces. So looking at actual listings from dealers, compiling those to come up with estimated prices for heavy duty ICE vehicles. So really all of those vehicle specs on the class 4 to 8 side has been totally revamped as a part of 2.0 and is much more comprehensive due to that manual data collection that we've undergone.
Thank you for that. Yeah. And to address another question that's a little bit ahead, if it can be used for school buses, it absolutely can. So long as it's on the market in the US, you can absolutely. Mm-hmm. And same for, it's not just for passenger vehicles, as you can see by all this. So that's to address that. As for the next question, is the fleet import necessary to get the fleet mapping?
I'm happy to handle it. It's a good question. I think we skipped pretty quickly through it, but in that fleet import step, we do have the option to use sample data. So we have a sample fleet baked into the tool. And so you can just go ahead and hit use sample fleet on that fleet import step, and that'll take you right into the fleet mapping step. You do still have to put in your zip code so that we can determine some of those default values. But I highly recommend that. I'll also clarify that along with the results, DRVE is totally open source. So all of the underlying data is available in that tool. So if you are just interested in, you know, some of the data driving the tool and maybe doing your own analyses or using it elsewhere, All of that data is available, and as well as all of the code and tables that go into the tool.
Rightly so, yeah. And for the following question I see pop up, can you filter for vehicle to grid or V2G capable EVs? I don't think there's a specific filter for that, especially since of how new it is, particularly for the market. But that's definitely an interesting take I see right there. And I like the thinking behind that. But to say, no, there is not a specific filter, but you can for certain vehicles that do offer it, like the Ford F-150 Lightning, you can use those if you know that they are V2G capable and use those in your analysis. So running a special separate fleet just for those V2G capable vehicles that you have identified and would like to consider in your TCO analysis. I think the next question on this list is, I see, does the platform help analyze the available grid capacity at local substation that could be allocated to the site? It's not to that degree for certain that the drive tool can be used. It's very interesting how you're thinking about it and great in terms of thinking about charging, because most folks we talk to, they just are interested in the EVs. What's important in both puzzle pieces is charging and EVs. And so there are dozens of resources out there that are currently being in development. I think there is one NREL resource I can follow up with as well. But that's to say, no, drive tool, unfortunately, is just for EVs and those little cost estimates. So next we have, this is a larger one. Is there a way to include customer side electric infrastructure costs, not just the chargers, which can end up being a larger percentage of the total cost of electrifying the fleet? Are utility make ready incentives available? I can add that there should be, oh, thank you. There are ways to bake in those types of costs, even though they're not specific presets you can find. But
yeah, I would add in that there's a lot of different types of costs that can go into the cost of installing charging infrastructure and maintaining that charging infrastructure, and that the way the tool works is ultimately it has to get down to a per port cost in order to bake that into the analysis. And so we've grouped that together into one upfront per port input that you saw us enter in the tool, that should ideally include, if that's how you're running your analysis, those electrical upgrade costs. That's really not intended to just be the purchase price of the charger. So while it's one input in the tool, that input's intended to represent, the comprehensive costs of installing one port. And so definitely recommend fleets to understand those electrical infrastructure costs, understand how those are going to be distributed across the different charging stations, and then sort of do that work on their side to come up with the appropriate per port upfront cost, which is why, again, it varies really significantly depending on the available grid capacity at your site to the previous question. So that's where it's really important for fleet managers to do a little bit of legwork. If you're hoping to have an analysis that really takes that stuff into account, because in our defaults, there's so much variation in it that it's really hard to capture the specific site characteristics that can significantly impact those costs.
Rightly so, yeah. And speaking of cost, how does ownership strategy impact the analysis? I will note that it's really dependent on a wide variety of factors, but there has, like Spencer had shown briefly on his walkthrough, there's a variety of ownership strategies that you can include in the procurement section of analysis settings.
Yeah, I'm happy to jump in on that. Really what it includes is it adds the financing costs. So if you're modeling a loan purchase, you're going to have to input your interest rate, and then the tool will calculate the total cost paid to in interest and factor that into the cost per mile. Leases can get more complicated, but it's the same principle where you can add in the financing costs related to that lease that increase costs above and beyond a cash purchase.
Gotcha. Thank you for that. And I see the next one. Spencer, would you like to take that?
Yeah, sure. It's a question we get very often about how the depreciation costs are calculated, because that's generally the largest part of the largest cost category. Mm-hmm. And so it's also one of the biggest things that we updated in 2.0. Basically what the tool does is it's taking the upfront purchase price of the vehicle, and then it's modeling the fair market value of that vehicle over time. So if you're modeling a Tesla Model 3 procurement, we're modeling what's that worth in year one, what's that vehicle's fair market value in year two, what's that vehicle's fair market value in year three, et cetera, until you get to, let's say you said you're using the vehicle for 8 years. In year eight, we're going to calculate the fair market value of that vehicle, and we're going to subtract it from the upfront cost or the upfront purchase price of what you paid for the vehicle. And then that difference will be the total depreciation cost. So the cost that you paid up front minus the value of the vehicle at the end of its useful life. And then we'll divide that by the number of miles driven to get that down to a cost per mile. Well, one of the things that was really exciting about 2.0 is that that depreciation curve is based on real world used vehicle sales data. And when we first built the tool, that was a very limited sample size because the EV market was relatively new and we didn't have a ton of data on, you know, the residual value of EVs. That's changed a lot since then. And so we're able to revamp that depreciation model to much more accurately cost or assess how EVs keep their value over time. So that's a really important, but a little bit behind the scenes update.
Yeah, a little bit behind the wheel.
Yep.
I think the next question here is there a 120 volt option for charging for the charging strategy section? Go ahead.
We do not have a 120 volt level one option, but all of those are customizable. So you can put in the relevant price for that charger, and it's going to use whatever price you use. So you could use the base level two charger and change that price to whatever's, you know, the reality facing your fleet and the charging infrastructure you're installing. And that'll adapt to that. Although I love the suggestion, I think that's something we could look at adding because I am a personal believer in the value of level one charging, at least for personal EVs.
Yeah, exactly. It may not be as advantageous for, say, larger fleets or level one chargers for that matter, but definitely there are use cases where it's certainly valid in use. Next question here is there a potential chance to include real-time data from telemetrics or annual mileage inputs from the existing fleet to get even more specific with the comparison outputs? I'll take a first stab at this. You can input annual mileage for sure. That's exactly what you should put for the vehicle miles traveled section in when you're uploading your fleet data in particular. But as for telematics, there are ways of inputting some of the data that you get from the outputs, like especially if it's like just average cost for utility rate or diesel gas prices that are estimated sometimes in telematics, in addition to, like mentioned, annual mileage as well. But Spencer, do you have anything to add there?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it's a balance we're currently striking with the drive tool between, you know, customizing and mapping every single vehicle in your fleet, because I think what it's getting at is maybe there are some times where, you know, one Toyota Corolla in your fleet, you'd want to map to a certain, you know, a Nissan Leaf, whereas other ones, maybe you would want to map to a Tesla Model 3. And I think that we decided that level of effort was, you know, was going to potentially slow down too many users to map every single vehicle. And so we did stick to mapping, you know, one vehicle type at a time. But like Steph was mentioning, inputs like annual vehicle miles traveled that are really key inputs, those are set at the vehicle level in your fleet data. So you will model separately and can view in the results separately if you have one Toyota Corolla that travels 8,000 miles a year and one that travels 15,000 miles a year. Those will be modeled separately and the results will reflect that difference in total cost of ownership.
Mm-hmm. Rightly so. Yeah, like mentioned, there's more ways than one to bake in the costs or different types of analysis settings that you would like to include. Next question here, as we approach time, we can fit in maybe one or two more. Do the lifetime savings include the costs of the vehicles that would be more expensive to electrify, or is it just the savings on EV and parity vehicles? We kind of touched on this, but Spencer, if you would want to dive into it.
Yeah, so that's just on savings and parity vehicles. So that's going to be exclusively savings, assuming you electrify the vehicles that show savings if they're electrified. Such is not going to be a negative number ever.
Yeah, exactly. Here's an easy question, which is, would this information entered, so your fleet data that is entered, be kept private, or can anyone see this information? I will say flat out, this is all on your device, on your PC. This will not be shared with anyone, and that's it. It is a one-way system, how Drive works, in terms of like pulling, for example, the decoding the VINs. It's not pulling from your data per se, it's just pulling it from Federal Highway Administration, from their database, to make sure that the VINs that you have entered are what is registered. So that is all to say, no, all of this is private information. None of it is public.
Yeah, it's a good flag while we're on that, that in order to keep it, that's one of the main reasons we've kind of continued to keep this as an Excel-based tool, is that it has the ability to run totally locally on your computer. But also just to flag that that does mean that when we update the tool on a quarterly basis, that we're going to have to come and download the latest version of the tool, because again, since it's local, we can't push updates sort of directly to the Excel workbooks on your local device. So that's definitely been very high priority to us, because I know VINs can be potentially sensitive information that it's important for fleets to know where those are going.
Exactly. Especially as you and I have both worked with some more private fleets that would rather not have their data out, and understandably so, it's a right for them. Moving on to the next question, this will be our final, I think. Yes. How does that work ultimately? You've touched on this in it, but if I may jump in, it's essentially seeing, if not electrifying fleet vehicles today, what about in the near future? And in this newest version of the Drive tool, it definitely takes account of the certain years that you would like to input or see how it is advantageous. But Spencer, I'll let you chime in if you have anything to add.
Yeah, I should emphasize that the forecasting is projected. Nobody really knows what electrification is going to cost in 2030, but hopefully we can provide some helpful ideas. The main thing that the tool incorporates that's going to impact a procurement in 2030 compared to today is expected changes in vehicle prices over time. So there's a lot of good research. We use NREL's research specifically, where they forecasted that I don't know the exact numbers, but that a all-electric SUV is going to, the average purchase price is going to decline by 7% between now and 2030. And so what the tool does, if you have forecasting selected, is it's going to take the purchase price that you entered, or the MSRP, for all of your electric SUVs in the fleet. So if I had a Nissan Ariya that I put in at 40,000, and for the 2030 forecast, it's going to decrease that upfront purchase price by 7%. It's going to do the same thing with ICE vehicles, where it's going to say, you know, fuel economy of gas SUVs is expected to increase by 2%, and prices are expected to increase by 1%. And so we're going to take the current fuel economy and the current price of every gas SUV in your fleet that's been modeled, and we're going to increase the fuel economy by 2% and the price by 1%, and then run the analysis. So that's its vehicle prices, its fuel economy, and its energy prices. We're also using forecasted from the US EIA, forecasted electricity, gas, and diesel prices through 2030. So those are really the key inputs that we're modeling projected changes in when we're talking about forecasting.
Awesome. Thank you for that. That was actually something I didn't know as much of. So awesome. More you know. Last but not least question, we have an easy one. This person has contracted utility rates and gasoline and diesel, so all of their fuel costs are contracted out. Can they include this in their analysis? Yes, you can, for sure. This is something that we definitely had kept in mind for especially making those sections customizable for those that do have those contracted rates. So, with that said, I think we can close out Q&A. Thank you everyone for such a robust section, and we can then start closing out. Okay, so for the rest of this, as we finish up, I would like to thank everyone once again for joining us today on the webinar, and I would definitely look forward to hearing from you all in the next one, for sure. Take care, folks.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you, Steph. Like a ride, oh, not easily offended, not let it go.